lives, that might be the biggest challenge.
Yeah.
But legitimate question for certain. Shall we get into some of the other fan views?
Yeah.
Do you want to
So,
start with Andrew Hinton?
yeah, Andrew Hinton, who is at Fax Blue Nose, said, "Please get rid of the Super League title as it's too widespread among many other sports. We need our identity as rugby league because that's what the sport is. Praying that the realignment takes the game forward and showcases our fantastic sport." Totally agree
Other
with
than we'd have to
everything
rebrand.
there. Yeah, okay.
Think about the little people, Andrew.
But yeah, it's true, isn't it? Women's football is Super League, netball is Super League.
Yeah, there's football leagues around the world that are called the, I think the Greek football leagues are Super League as well. There is an argument to say, do we consider a rebrand? And I guess that would be part of this entity's remit because the branding is part of the commercial entity that we are.
Yeah.
Well, hopefully someone's listening and has it down on the list of things to think about. Ben at Wakey White, I think his thing says, "I've been about a bit," but in a kind of colloquial way. Anyway, that's what he's going with at the moment, is Ben. He said, "It's the same organ grinders and the same monkeys." So I can't determine from that if he went negative impact or no meaningful impact, but I think what he's saying is the more things change, the more they stay the same. No meaningful impact.
It's certainly not positive impact he's voted for, isn't it? Yeah, David Lawrenson, who's at David Laura, said fundamental change is needed and not fiddling with the deck chairs. A third entity seems a strange way to realign.
I understand that point. What I would say is, to me, it is quite a realignment because what we've done in the past is jumped from Super League being a little bit separate, then the RFL taking charge of the reins again, and then Super League jumping out of that again. I think this gives that it is a different way of doing it that we've not tried yet in the era of the kind of Super League, the big TV deal, relatively speaking, and that sort of area of it. I don't. That's what I see from the third thing, but it depends who's going to make up that board, like you said, Sarah.
Yeah.
Hull Kiwi at Hull Kiwi said RFL plus Super League equals same shit, different day. So that's just a different way of saying what Ben said, I think.
Very succinct. Ian Gatwood said, "I will await to see what happens with the new venture, which is a massive step forward for the sport, and hopefully the political infighting that has affected the sport will cease. I still wonder, though, with the pyramid of sport as it is, how this will be affected financially and structurally, and who will have what say in the running of the sport."
That was a much more succinct way of saying the meat on the bone stuff that I rambled on about, so well done, Ian. Carsten said, "A third body, really? FMD, money for the boys." What does FMD, Sarah? What does that mean? I'm out of touch.
I've got no idea.
So it's probably something cool people know.
My kids will have to educate me on.
Yeah.
Well, I've just Googled it and it's not what he's saying, I don't think, because it's fibromuscular
Ah, okay. They probably could do with some money for those boys.
dysplasia.
Yeah.
But anyway, Paul Lear, who's at Paul241 Lear, said, "Lower leagues struggle for recognition when it's been separate boards looking after them. No chance now they're being, quote marks, looked after by one board with Super League."
Well, if there's a constitutionally ingrained split of profits, then and you'd need a voting majority to change that somewhere down the line, and the RFL have two of the votes. I'm not sure I agree with Paul, but I understand the skepticism because of how the Super League have acted in the last period. I don't know, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, you do worry that that might be the case. But you'd hope with the parts of the board being represented by people appointed by the RFL, that it wouldn't be, but potentially it could be.
I suppose it stays a proportion, doesn't it? So there's no chance of catching up from the lower leagues. You still have to progress through the leagues to be at that biggest piece of the pie level for those lower teams.
Yeah.
Tom Andrews said, until I see something positive from this, this will just appear to be a creation of more high-paying management jobs, organising meetings about when to organise meetings, happy to be proven wrong. Fuck me dead. Is that what you're telling me it means?
Yeah, that's what I've just found out, but I didn't want to interrupt your flow.
No, that's, yeah, that's different, isn't it, to what we thought before? Fair enough. That covers a few views. You can see from those views why the no meaningful impact won out. But there was a couple of people in there with some optimism as well, wasn't there? So.
Yeah, I think at the moment it's still a case of too many questions, isn't it, for a lot of people to have much positive or negative. You know, we just don't. There's too many questions still, I think.
Yeah, yeah. So our kind of inbuilt expectations and biases and not what have you will still prevail. I think so much people call out for change, but also so many people say we change too much. I think we're talking about different things, aren't we? People want change to the governance of the sport, but don't want change to the rules of the sport, like a try from your own half being 5 points, for fuck's sake, shut up. Yeah. Let's make it more complicated. So, yeah, we're torn as rugby league. I think we're always torn as a sport. Hopefully having something that is a third body that unites, a bridge between any kind of split. I don't know. I'm optimistic or hopeful. Hopeful is the word rather than optimistic, probably.
Yeah.
Right. Well, that's something to kick the can down the lane on that one now, and we'll find out more as time goes on. But put a bookmark on this episode to come back to and see if the poll was on the money or not in 2 or 3 years' time. We'll move on to more immediate matters now.
When they change it again,
yeah. good point. we'll move on now to more immediate matters and talk about round 4 of Super League. Super League round 4, the first game was over in Wakefield, where it finished Leeds Rhinos 34, Wakefield Trinity 18. It was 30-0 to the Rhinos at half time, so job was done, but Wakey won the second half. 5,040 were there. Chris Kendall was there as well with the whistle. In terms of the team stats, Leeds picked Bodine Thompson. He continues to not exist in number form, so there's incomplete team stats. But from the numbers we do have, we can actually see that Wakey themselves fell below 90% team tackle success rate, which often means a loss. And Leeds made over 150 more metres and twice as many breaks, not including any ground that Thompson gained that might add into that. So Leeds were quite comprehensively better on the numbers. What about the individual performers, Sarah?
Yes, individually, Ash Handley with 3 tries, 8 tackle busts, 206 metres and 2 clean breaks. Jack Walker with 1 try assist, 11 tackle busts and 153 metres. Liam Sutcliffe with 3 try assists, 105 metres. And Cameron Smith with 44 tackles, of which 12 were marker tackles. For Wakefield, David Fafita with 10 tackle busts and 132 metres. Tom Johnston with 1 try assist and 121 metres.
I think it should be 1 try. I think I've screwed that up, sorry.
Okay. James Batchelor with 1 try assist, 108 metres. And Jordan Crowther with 43 tackles.
Ash Handley's numbers were... Ash Handley got the top fantasy score of the year so far with those numbers.
Really?
Yeah. Sorry, what were you saying?
I was just saying there were a lot of tackle busts overall in that match then.
Well, that's what gets you below 90% team tackle success rate, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Always in our shadow said, Winos finally remember how to play, helped by playing a very weakened Trinity team and the obligatory poor calls from Mr. K. Two wingers on show who Wayne overlooked, both getting over the line.
Yep, Callum Percy, 99, said, shit, put football on, what a game, middle for the Spurs.
Dr. Bob Phillips said, Wakefield were scrappy and looked beaten from early on. Perking up only a bit at the end when the Rhinos had stopped thinking. Handley was excellent, but the thing that most impressed was an attacking shaped back. Also, Eddie Batty has a proper traditional rugby league body shape.
John Hamilton said, another great start, and this time put plenty of points on. Better from Walker and Caesar. Defence was tougher, and the enthusiasm from game one was back. It got a bit sloppy at the end, which will need tightening up against the top teams, but good improvement and a win. The treble is on.
Carsten said, I knew they planned to rebuild Bellevue, but forgot to inform the players that this will start later this year. It is bad. At least they arrived in the second half and showed that they can play the game. Leaming card was tough, but within the new rules. Fuzzer 2 will cop a ban for that shoulder charge. P.S. Bloody Chris Kendall.
I thought Chris was his first name.
Ah, not his middle name.
Yeah. Anyway. Maybe he changes it depending.
I don't think he gets Chris in Hall, does he? Or Bloody.
Rich Wilkinson said, a good win for the Rhinos. Any win against Wakey is a good win. It's always tough as it's arguably their biggest rivalry with Cass. Second half wasn't great. Don't agree with the yellow card. Looked like the best tackle of the night.
Wakey White said, the scoreline looks semi-respectable thanks to a couple of late tries, but in truth this was a real hammering for Wakey. Didn't help that Miller went off after 5 minutes. We had two forwards in the centres and young Murphy on the wing, who had a torrid debut, but I still expected more than we got. A shame because we've been competitive so far this year, but this was an unmitigated shambles.
And White Pie said, well, if Wakey aren't careful, it might not be Toulouse getting relegated. Abject in the first half and leads barely broke a sweat, although that penalty that led to the first try was questionable. They made a contest of it in the second half, and for Leeds, Harry Newman shared again. He's made of shortbread, picking up another knock in his first game of the year. You can't judge Leeds on this game, but Wakey were dire.
Right, a few bits to unpack. What did you have noted as the first things to cover?
I thought that the Cruz leaving one was harsh. Sim Binning, I think. I thought it was quite a dire match generally. It wasn't a spectacle, was it?
No. There was maybe the Gannon try that was well worked, weren't it? And I think, was that the second try or the third try? Walker was really good in the build up for that, as he was throughout the game actually. But quite a few of the other scores were preventable, to say the least. There was poor defensive reads, they came off the back of errors, or there was weak efforts in defence. So I think that takes away some of the gloss a little bit from the neutral spectator point of view, doesn't it? The Leeming Sinbin, yeah. After watching that Sinbin show last week with Paul Cullen talking about what kind of they're doing now about high tackles, and Robert Hicks was saying that the actual on-field assessment of them actually changed at the start of last year, not at the start of this year. Maybe the refs are just spotting them better this year, I don't know. But in terms of what Cullen was saying, this was one of those ones, I think, where the argument is you're going at such a speed that you lose some of your control, and so that's what pushes it into yellow card territory if you do catch him round the chin, which he did catch him round the chin, but not full whack. So it's an adjustment. One like that's an adjustment. Leeming on the Super League show was quite, accepting of it and understanding of that's how it goes now, and they're trying to protect our heads so that we have a life after rugby and that sort of thing. So, you know, he seemed to accept it, but he did get a grade B high tackle charge, a one match penalty notice, and I think last year that probably would have been at worst a grade A charge, maybe a caution, from what Cullen said in how they've changed the off field disciplinary guidelines for those sort of things. So I agree it's one that we wouldn't